today's offering is for our local church budget. Tyler's story is where there's a will. A registered nurse worked on the oncology ward in a large hospital. It was tough. It was a tough job, one in which the caregivers often grew to love their own patients, only to lose them to one or another cancer. This is the story of one of those patients as observed by the nurse. We'll call her Gladys. Sadly, Gladys' family seldom came to visit her. Day after day, the chairs in her room were empty, and the only cheer she received was from her attendants. It appeared then when she was not going to survive, however, by what seemed at the time was a minor miracle, she rallied to improve enough to return to her home. What did she find out when she got there? That her greedy children had completely cleaned out her place. All of her furniture, appliances, and clothes, everything was gone. Her place was in stripped bare. She was devastated. She called a taxi to return to the hospital bed. Heartbroken and completely discouraged, she soon succumbed to her own injuries. She was elated and had these questions. Do you have the will? And is it current? Bachelors and funeral directors have witnessed perfectly awful things happen to families because they had no will. Lifelong bonds have been shattered because of heated arguments, others' properties and possessions. Please do not go to on another day without living without will. Dearly Father, I pray that you would bless the hands who are able to give, the ones who can't, their hearts, you know, what they desire to do. We also pray that we all have the will to actually do something about our circumstances and don't let the outside background noise, so to speak, influence what we're doing. Give us that will to do what's right and what's morally correct. Always thank you, pray in your precious name. Thank you.
everyone to be good, and everyone that has the food to get better. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Yes, once again, please keep a lot of people in prayer because the flu is going around. Okay. So today is the last Sabbath of the year, correct? Okay. So that means that we are approaching a new year. So a lot of people, they end up doing something. They set something as a goal. Does anybody know what that word is? A new year's resolution. Thank you. Yes, exactly. But so you might hear your parents or friends or cousins or grandmother, grandpa, whoever, maybe speaking about wanting to set certain goals this year. But did you know even at your age you can do that as well? Yes. So if we do, you can ask any of your family members to help you out with setting these goals. When we practice achieving goals, it helps with communication and decision making even at a young age. All of that is very important. And so you can go back to your parents or whomever takes care of you and tell them, hey, you know, I want to set some goals this year. And they can tell you what they've done in the past. So let's talk about a few examples here. So say you were thinking, I'm going to start helping around the house this year. Well, that's pretty broad and pretty vague, so we've got to be a little more specific about it. So maybe you can say, this year I want to help setting the table for dinner time or for breakfast time. Or you can say, I want to start helping out with washing the dishes if you're not already doing that, okay? Or tidying up your room, okay? So those are a little bit more specific for you. Another thing is, I'm going to start being nicer to people. Well, that's, again, pretty vague and broad. So say you go to school, you can say, you know, once a week I'm going to make one new friend. Or I'm going to say hi to one new person that I've never spoken to before. Okay? Another thing that we can think about is screen time. There's a lot of screen time this day and age. And so you can say, I'm going to cut down on the amount of screen time I have. Once again, that's pretty vague. So we can say we can cut that down to 1 hour a day. Okay? And so you see how we took something big and made it very small. And we don't want to, when it comes to parents or any caregivers, we don't want to make it a negative thing. We always want to make these resolutions very positive. So that's another aspect to look at. And so do help your young ones to make these goals and to achieve it along the way. You guys can map that. And it will also just kind of help out with character building too, just to see that they can make goals, set it, and actually achieve it. And so let's go ahead and have a prayer with our guest here, Sister Mary Gani.
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing us to be here worshiping you. And thank you for the little one that you allowed to be here with us. And thank you for the story. Thank you for the sister and for everybody who's here. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, we can go back to our seats. Thank you, you guys.
Sufficient for me and you. Can you put a little higher? He's coming. So you have to put the song a little higher for him.
Insurance policy on both spouses, just like they do for the partnership agreement. The wife will have insurance on the husband, and she will be the beneficiary, and vice versa. So somebody advised her that she can get the cheap insurance at the bank. So she came to the bank to see me, and we sat down, and she talked. And I listened to her, she said everything that I have told you now, but more details. And after she has finished talking, I leaned forward on my desk towards her. And I said, man, we don't offer cheap insurance. And I said, however, if you want something affordable, I'll be able to show you. So she laughed, she said, you know what I mean? No, I don't know what you mean. soon as the branch manager saw her, he went to her and offered to help her. She said, "No, I'd like to speak to Harry, okay?" The branch manager came to me and said, "Harry, you have a young lady waiting for you." That's when I said, "I'll see her." She said, "Don't keep her waiting too long." I said, "I won't." So I finished with my customer, and then I walked the customer out. I went to her side by her side, shook her hands, we talked for a while, and then she said, "I just came here to tell you that I won't be able to do anything this month because my husband doesn't have the time to come to the bank with me. So maybe next month I'll let you know." And I sat there and I thought, she doesn't have to come all the way to the bank to tell me this. She can call me, she has my business card, she can call me and tell me this. Or she can come when she's ready. But before I opened my mouth to say something to her, she stood up and picked her bag. And then she said, "I just want to get this thing done and over with." I read her body language very quick and her facial expression, and I noticed that she was not only disappointed, but she was distressed. So immediately I said to her, "I tell you what I will do for you. Come with me." So I walked her to my desk. We sat there and I said, I'm not supposed to do this. It's against regulations. But if you work with me, I'll work with you. I'm going to give you all the applications. Take them home. Have your husband sign it. Just his signature. I don't want anything else on the application. Just his signature. And if you can come with any ID, that I'll be able to prove his signature and his date of birth, I'll work with you without your husband coming in." Her face lit like a Christmas tree. She said, "You will?" I said, "This is against bank policy, but I'll do it for you." And then she said, "Oh, Mr. Okai, you are a gentleman, whatever that means, you know." And I walked out, gave her all the information, she left. The following day, she came back. And when she came, we sat down and we filled out the forms together. I verified the signature, everything verified. And I went to the teller room, fixed the account, and came, gave him the information, and I was preparing for him, preparing her life insurance. And then she said, she was sitting in front of me, but she was sitting sideways like this, so she can see the street. It's a big glass house. You can see people walking on the street, the cars and everything. You have a restaurant on the third floor. You're walking around, you can see the people sitting. You wave them, they can wave you down. So she was looking straight outside. And she said, "Mr. Kai." And I looked at her from the top of her glass like this. She said, "Are you married?" I said to myself, "What?" She said, "Are you married?" I have only met the lady three times in a week. But before, she was a potential customer, but now she's a customer. And when a customer asks a question, you gotta give the customer an answer. So, with a little reservation, I said, "I was." She wasn't looking at me, she was still looking outside, but I could see that she can see my face from her peripheral vision. I could see. And then she said, "So you're no longer married?" And I said, "That is correct." And then there was silence. And then, almost as if I wasn't there, she was just talking to herself. And then she said, "Stay looking outside. I am married to this man for all the wrong reasons. I don't know why I did it. I don't love him. I don't love him at all. Oh, I'm a stupid girl." And I looked at him. drop on the desk and looked at her, she still wasn't looking at me. And then at the same time, I felt as if I heard my mother's voice from a distant place talking to me in the vernacular. She said, "Harry, Efo Yetibne. Harry, she's crying with him. Esumo ni ona ake Efo. She doesn't want you to see that she's crying." And all of a sudden, I felt so concerned about her. I started to feel the pain. I started to feel the disappointment, her crying and her trembling. And I said, 5 months married, and she feel this way? But the truth is that we all have been there, one way or the other. It doesn't have to be married, but there have been times in our lives where we have made a decision, because it's a decision that she made to marry the guy. We have made this decision in life that we wish we had never made. Sometimes we say, I wish I had never done this. But we all do this. We all do it. Sometimes you buy a car or you buy a house and you wish you had not done it. We all have come to a point in our lives sometime that we wish we have never made the decision that we did. It just happened that this lady, it was with her marriage, and she was very, very distressed. But if we go to the book of Solomon, we know that Solomon was a wise man. Supposedly he was the wisest man that ever walked. I wonder if Solomon was so wise because of the decisions that Solomon made. The choices that Solomon made, that's what made him a wise person. And the choices he made them not because he's such a smart guy, but because God gave him, God blessed him with the wisdom to make those choices. So as Christians, it is very important for us to make the right choices. Now, if you go to the book, the Old Testament word that relate to wisdom, read from those that speak of skill and reasoning ability to those that emphasize understanding. Now, the skilled artisan is wise. The king or the ruler is wise. If he rules well, the Old Testament taught wisdom is the dominant aspect of wisdom is moral. To the Old Testament believer or believers, as well as our present day Christians, a person is wise if he or she can make morally correct decisions or choices and eventually live a life that is pleasing to God. A wise person has to make a morally correct decision tonight. Now, in the book of Exodus, chapter 28, verse 3, it says, "And thou shalt speak to all that are wise hearted, whom I have filled with the spirit of wisdom, that they may make the Aaron's garment to consecrate him, that he might minister unto me in the priest's office." And when you go to James chapter 1 verse 5, it says, "If anybody lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth liberally to all men and upbraideth not, and it shall be given unto him." What the Bible is telling us clearly here that wisdom is a gift that comes only from God, but one has to ask for it. You have to ask for it, God will give. God is the only one who gives wisdom. And in James chapter 1, verse 17, he said, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of light, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. In the New Testament language, and also our own tongue, wisdom doesn't speak of intelligence or eloquence, but of application and interpretation. Knowing the Bible is a good thing. Knowing what the Bible says is a very good thing. But what good is very good if we don't apply what the Bible says to our lives? It is meaningless unless the knowledge that we have acquired from the Bible, we can apply it to our lives. In the book of Hosea, chapter 14, verse 9, he said, who is wise, and he shall understand these things? Prudent, and he will understand this. He said, for the ways of the Lord are right, the just shall walk in them, but the transgressor shall fall therein. God has given us so much. God has been so good to us that he has given us not only the word, but he has given us the Holy Spirit as well. To lead us, to guide us, to teach us how to apply the written word onto our lives. Now you see, for the average Christian like you and me, wisdom involves accepting the will of God on things and acting on those things accordingly. You will say, but how do we know that this is from God? And I will say, let's go to the book of Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7. If the book of Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7 says, the fear of God is the beginning of knowledge. The wise despise wisdom and instruction. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 6. It says, it's the Lord that gives wisdom. Out of his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. James chapter 3, verse 13. He said, who is a wise man and endure with knowledge? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. The Lord has given us so much that with the Holy Spirit in us and the word with us, by us, we can know the viewpoint of God in any situations that we may find ourselves. If you go to the book of Matthew chapter 25, Jesus Christ identified and demonstrated two types of wisdom there. In the story of the 10 virgins, we all know the story. 5 of them were wise. 5 of them were foolish. Now, what made one set of group wise and another set of group foolish? It's simple. It's their line of choices. The choices they made. All the 10 virgins had the same information about the bride and the groom. They have the same information, the same facts about the date, the time, and the location. The foolish bride, they looked at all the information and they just wanted to go there and enjoy themselves. The wise, they look at the information and they look at the time and they were probably able to say, very slow inn or a place open at this time of the night in miles. So they said, sisters, let us take some extra oil in case. And you know the story? Those who didn't think about it, they just wanted to have fun. They didn't even see the bride. But those who took upon themselves to look at the situation, they were able to enjoy themselves. So our choices can either break us or make us. And as Christians, the most difficult or the most important thing that I see as Christians, or as the challenging part of Christianity, is praying and making morally correct choices. The book of, this I'd like somebody to help me, the book of Daniel chapter 2, verses 17 to 23. I'll let somebody read it so the church may be edified. What I'm talking about, praying and making morally correct choices. Daniel chapter 2, verses 16 to 23.
Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time and that he would show the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies from the God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the season. He removeth kings and set up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding.
Amen. See, Daniel didn't just go to the king to tell the king what the king wanted to know. He spoke with his friends. He said, let's pray and ask God. God came through for them. So if our choices can make us or break us, why is it that we take it so light? Why is it that we make the choice first, and then when things don't go the way we want, then we go to God to fix it for us? Wouldn't it be much easier for us to go to God first and present everything to God in prayer? And then allow God to give us the strength to make. And when we make the choice, we should be disciplined enough to hold on to it. It doesn't matter how it comes out. It might not be what we expected, but once we commit ourselves to God and we make the choice, we should be able to know that this is the will of God.
Amen.
Now, the same book, Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 to 18. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 to 18. Sometimes we pray for something specific, and it doesn't happen the way we want it. So we think maybe God didn't hear our prayers, or God didn't listen to our prayers. But if we are disciplined enough to believe in God, whether it came out the way we want it or not, we still know God is in control. And that's why I want somebody to read Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 to 18, so we see.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from this burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up.
Amen. See, this is what faith in God does. Once you believe in God and you commit yourself to him and you pray about it, it doesn't matter how the outcome comes. You are no more in control. Once you give it to God, You may want it this way, but if it doesn't come that way, you still have to thank God for it. So Daniel and his family are demonstrating exactly what we're talking about, choices. We will make choices all our life. As soon as we come out from here, we'll be making choices. You know, some of us have made choices this year that we don't like. I work with a guy in New York, 6 years married, and they've been planning to go on a cruise. And they started preparing, buying everything. They drove from New York to Florida to go on the cruise. And they came back separately. And that was the end of it. And the wife said, I wish I had never gone on this cruise. This is something that she was looking forward to. She planned for it, they prepared for it, they want to go. And now she says she wished she had never done that. But like I said, we all go through that one way or the other. I had a Grand Am car when I was in New York, was doing my bachelor's. I love the car. But every week I have to put money into the car. Every week I have to put, every time I make a little bit money, I have to put it in the car. As much as I love the car, as soon as I finish my bachelor's, I took the car. And maybe that's my reason why I have never bought an American car. That's true. I was so disappointed. I love the car, but I was just putting too much money in the car. You know, and I hated the day I bought the car. We all do it. You know, you do something, you want it so much, and then later on you wish you had not done it. So we have to sincerely commit ourselves, just like the scripture reading said. We have to commit ourselves to God, and we have to let Him guide us in the things we do, that we will make the right choices, and no matter what the result, we will still believe in God, that He has allowed us to make these choices. There's another wisdom that the Bible talks about, but the Bible cautions us about it. That was in, it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 to 20. He says, let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seems to be wise in this world, let him be a fool in order to be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God. And he said, for it is written that he takes the wise in their own craftiness. And again, God knows the thought of the wise that they have been. The only wisdom that we need, and what the Bible talks about, is the wisdom from God. Unless God gives you that wisdom, you will be self-proclaimed wise person. And self-proclaimed wise person are people who think they know everything. Anything you say, they know. Anything you say, they know. But those who are wise, probably the wisest person is always the person, a man or a woman, who thinks of himself or herself the least so. You never say anything but you make wise decision. A wise decision is very, very important for us to, you know, as Christians to walk by. Wisdom is being disciplined enough to trust in God and hold on to Him no matter what the outcome. So as Christians, and we are going to enter into a new year now, my desire is that we will get much closer to God, that we will pray that you will bring us wisdom from above, that our choices for the coming year will be in line with God's will. In the book of Proverbs chapter 8 verse 11, it says, wisdom is better than rubies. All the things that we desire cannot be compared to it. Now if you see that in your analysis, just think about anything that you do or you have done or you want to do. You can never start without first making a choice. You have to make a choice whether you want to do it this way or you want to do it that way. But once you make the choice, you own it. And one thing also, Christians, we are very quick if our choices that we made doesn't go the way we want it, to blame the devil. Of course, he's happy to take the credit. That's what he does. It doesn't matter how much he influenced you to make the wrong choice. You own the choice. God is not going to judge the devil on the choices that we make. Once we make the choice, we own it. The only thing the devil will be responsible for, the lies that he lied about God the Father and the Son, the Holy Ghost, and the destructions that he has given Christians. But the choices that we make here on earth, it doesn't matter what the influence, we own it. So if you make the choice, then Christian will have a tendency, if we make the choice first, to blame somebody. That's why we have to pray very hard. Bring everything to God. Once we make the choice, we should stay with the choice. And believe that God is with us and he's going to work us through. I made said to myself that I'm not going to stay longer here today because this is all, everything last week. I'm not supposed to be the speaker today. People have traveled, people are sick and everything. So, you know, it's the last minute thing that I think. So, you know, at this moment, I'm going to say, since we are starting a new year, people are making resolution, they're going to do, people are going to be more good. I would say, let us, as Christians, purpose in our heart that we will get closer to God and we will commit all our choices to God before we make them. That the good Lord will be able to help us in the things we do. And if this is your desire, that you want to make right choices next year, they are not easy though. Making choices are not easy. See, it was choice in heaven that kicked Lucifer and the other angels out. It was choice in the Garden of Eden that brought mankind down. How you call it? Judas made a choice just for 30 pieces of gold. He committed suicide after that. The kingdom of Israel was divided because of Rahab's decision he made. He took the advices of the honor instead of advice from his father. He almost lost the kingdom. The kingdom was divided because of simple choice. So, as insignificant as it sounds, it is a very important thing that Christians, I personally think, is the one most important thing that Christians we should pray for. That God will give us the wisdom from above that will make the righteous. God said it. He said, if you need wisdom, if you lack it, he will give it to you. So why is it that we don't have God? I mean, I've done many things myself that I feel like kicking myself because I didn't commit it to God in the first place. faithful that he has been able to pull us through many, many times. But one thing like I want all of us to be aware of, I've heard preachers make wrong choices and again, the devil, who the devil was. That's what he does. See, when he took Jesus to the pinnacle and showed him all the kingdoms of the world, and he said, if you jump, the angels will catch you. If Jesus has jumped, it's not his fault. It's not the devil's fault. You see, now, the choices that we make, we own them. It doesn't matter who influences to do it. We own them. And that's how we will be judged. About the choices that we make. So why it sounds so simple, it is the most important thing for us. You make you decide whether you want to, you know, continue your education or not. You decide whether you want to come to church on the Sabbath or not. You decide whether you want to stop coming to the church because somebody says something to you don't like. You can blame. Keep on blaming people, but you own it.
Mm-hmm. Great.
There's no two ways about it. Because God gave us the mind to make choices. You know, and if we make the wrong choice, we can blame it on everybody. We don't blame it on anybody if we make the right choice. We probably own it, accept it. But if we make the wrong choices, then we blame it on the devil. The devil is happy. You know, he will take all the credit he wants. You know, but actually you own your own choices. So at this time, I'm just going to bring it to, I just decided to talk about this so we all think about it for the rest of the day. And when we go to pray to God to give us the strength to go through this year, we should know that choices are the most important thing. It can make us or it can break us. There are a whole lot of people in the Bible, I can sit here and name as much as I can, who make choices. That brought them down, and then those who made choices that let them happen. But we cannot make the right choices unless we got wisdom from above. And God is the only one who gives this wisdom. He said, ask, and he shall give it to you. So we're going to close. We have a prayer leader here. She's going to pray. And if anybody here, I would say everybody, commit yourself to God this morning, that God will give you wisdom from above, that the year coming, you'll be making the right choices and you'll get much, much closer to God. And if this is your desire, as we sing the closing hymn, you know, you can come forward and our prayer leader will pray with you. Pray with you, pray for you that you'll be making the right choices. In Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your presence today. We thank you for the word of wisdom. We pray that your spirit will continue to lead us in Jesus' name. We pray. Amen.
Amen.
What's the number?
286.
Amen. We stand for our
seal. And everything we do, therefore, I say it again, if you need a prayer, that you'll be able to make much, much better choices. Please, you can come forward and we will pray for you.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Sister Kai, you're praying for this news.
Our Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we plead the blood of Jesus. We're asking for the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. First, God, we ask that you blot out all sins out of the book of sin and place our names in the book of life. We are here, O God, because we believe the word of wisdom that is spoken from your book. Lord, there are so many things that are pressing, O God, from the inner man, from the inner woman, from our imagination, our thoughts, the intents of our heart, but you said your word, O God, will be as a sword to cut, O God, whatever those things that are keeping us from seeing your face. Lord, we come in the name of Jesus according to James 1:5. If any of you lack wisdom, you say, let us ask of God and it shall be given to us liberally in the name of Jesus. Amen. There are so many decisions that are pressing, oh God, and we only want your decision. We don't have time, God. From the youngest to the eldest in this room, God, we're asking for wisdom in our choices, oh God, that we measure it, oh God, to your holy word. If it is not of thee, oh God, that we walk away or we run away from it in the name of Jesus. Lord, we bring every household to you, O God. We're asking that the spirit of wisdom, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, will permeate and take over and illuminate the dark places of our mind, our soul, in the name of Jesus. We give you, though, Lord, that. We heard about someone having new beginnings. Lord, your mercies are new every morning, and we want to walk in it in the name of Jesus. From schooling decisions, from marriage decisions, from relationship, from friends, oh God, from health decision, oh God. What shall we do, oh God? We bring all of our concerns, our imagination, the intents of our hearts to you, oh God. Lord, we are here standing in your sanctuary, God, not for form or fashion, because our hearts burn, oh God, for more of you in every situation, oh God. Our future, God, we lay it out to you. We don't know. We don't know which way to go, God. And we ask for wisdom in the name of Jesus. We ask that we get ourselves out of the way and we see all of you. God, you have given us glimpses and visions of things this year, oh God. And we don't even know what it means, but we are walking and talking. We want crazy faith in the name of Jesus, God. And we receive it in the name of Jesus, but we want to have wisdom with that crazy faith, God. And we thank you, God, that we trust you. When we cannot trace you. These new levels, these new time in life, we're retirement, God. We bring that to you, God, that we need. Now you're transforming us and moving us to a new level, and we're clueless and we're scared. But Lord, you said you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a sound mind, and we walk in the name of Jesus. We bring our children to you, God. They're acting crazy, and they don't even know what wisdom is, God. But we thank you and we speak it into their existence, in their mind, in their choices, in their friends, their relationship, our grandchildren, oh God. We plead the blood of Jesus. We plead wisdom, God. Our children that don't want us to have nothing to do with us, we ask that you give them wisdom. That you give them a heart after you, oh God. Oh, we thank you, God. We receive it and we move everything out of the way that is not like you, that is interfering, oh God, with your direct alignment to make moral, correct choices. Yeah. What three powerful words, yeah, of God. Because if they're not moral, then they're evil.
Amen.
And if they're not correct, then they're wrong.
Yes.
And choices, God, animals act like animals, but that is the difference between an animal and humans.
Yes.
You have given us the power of choice.
Yes.
And we ask that you anoint it in the name of Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit right now. Move foolishness far from us. We thank you, God, that you have everything in check and you are in charge. And you have the checkmate, God. And we let you play this life of chess, a game with you. We let you play it, God, as you give us strategy to move forward in faith, victorious in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you.
Amen.
While we do.